We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Hey, back again, y'all. This is Jerry Bell on LATalkLive.com radio. How y'all doing? We are here. In the background, you're listening to the sounds of my friends and my musical, my mate, Earth, Wind, and Fire. Yes, indeedy. Oh, yeah. You know, next week is going to be a very, very hot show. We have Ralph Johnson and Verdine White on the show from Earth, Wind, and Fire. So it's going to be hot, hot. And we got Tosh on the show, too, man. She's going to come on and do some spoken word for me.
Tosh?
Yeah.
Tosh who?
Tosh from...
From the Zabir Bay Show?
Yeah.
Oh, that's hot. Yeah, she's hot, man. She's got a great sound. She's... Her poetry is so conscious.
Man, I love her, man.
Big ups to her, man, no doubt.
The fire's going to love her, too.
So, welcome, Grandmaster Jerry Bell, to another episode of Jerry Bell's R&B and Soul Classics.
Classics, yes, sir.
That's a classic there, man. You pulled out the closet there on me, I see.
Oh, yeah,
man.
Old
Dusty and whatnot. So, what you got else coming up today?
Hey, man, Brahima is coming in and...
Waiting on my man Brahima Salam.
Yeah. But I got a nice little thing here for you, the listening audience. We want to give them some good radio.
Yeah.
These are my friends from Memphis, Tennessee. This was produced by Isaac Hayes. It's called Dedicated to the One I Love by the Temprees, y'all.
Thank you. satisfied, girl. Just knowing that you love me. There's one thing I want you to do. Especially for me. Hey, there's something everybody needs. While I'm away, ooh, baby, whisper a little
How in the world can a grandmaster of some of the most deadly forms of martial arts get up in those upper octaves?
Hey, really? Because I got them deadly vocals.
Yes, indeed you do. Grandmaster Jerry Bell in the background to the sounds.
Oh, the Tim Priest.
Man, what a great song.
Yeah, man. Yeah, this is beautiful, man. I missed them cats, man. A couple of the guys have passed on to the spiritual world, but you know, I've had an opportunity to work with them in the past, as well as with Isaac Hayes, and they used to put on a hellified show, man. Very, very wonderful gentleman too, you know. The one that's left is Scotty, and he's still performing. He still has a Tim Priest group together, and they're still performing.
Word. Tim Priest, give us a little background about them. Where were they from?
From Memphis.
Memphis, Tennessee.
Memphis, Tennessee. Yeah, they were on Stax Records.
Mm-hmm.
They were being produced by Isaac Hayes and also by Al Bell, actually, who owned the Stax Record label.
Another Bell.
Yeah. And they came out, you know, with Rufus Thomas, with Johnny Taylor, Isaac Hayes. They were on the Stax with Richard Pryor and the Barquets. The Emotions was on that label at one time as well too. You know? So and Luther Ingram, If Loving You Is Wrong.
I don't want to be right.
Yeah, man. So.
Well, you certainly pulled out a classic there.
Yeah, brother.
Today, there, Grandmaster Jerry Bell.
I got some stuff for you though.
Now, today our listeners are in for a very special treat. Because today, you're going to dedicate a lot of music to the listeners.
Yes, indeed.
My understanding is you've been getting quite a bit of positive feedback, no negativity whatsoever.
Right.
From listeners and viewers around the globe. You know, LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network is heard and viewed in over 150 countries globally. I was looking at some of the stats, global stats, and places like Belarus.
Yeah.
Kuwait, I can kind of imagine. Big ups to all of our soldiers over there in foreign lands.
Yes, indeed.
I know you're out there listening. Places like Croatia.
Yeah.
You know, must be loving some of this great talk and great music. But today is a very special episode of Jerry Bell's R&B Soul Classics, in that you are going to be playing a lot more music and giving our listeners a chance to enjoy some of the sounds of your times.
Yes, indeed.
And all times, for that matter. Not just yours, mine, of all times.
Right.
A lot of babies walking this planet right now.
Look,
have some of this great music to thank.
That's what people tell me when I run into them and they find out that I had the honor, actually, of singing with the New Birth and some of the other, you know, other groups that I had been, that I came up with. And they said, man, we made babies to your music, you know. And I was very happy about
and
that.
And they ain't lying to you either, Grandmaster. So, you know, not yet, because I'm still in training, as we put out before in previous episodes. we're going to have a special segment of the show where I will challenge the Grandmaster's musical selections. So today, I'm just like, this is just a little practice run.
All right, brother.
A little Curtis Mayfield and the impressions in the background.
And I got one for you.
Okay, all right, we'll see what it do.
Yes, indeed.
Check out the sounds.
You're only one fellow's girl. I'm so proud of being loved by you. And it would hurt to know if you ever were untrue. Sweeter than the taste of a cherry so sweet. And I'm so proud, girl.
I'm so proud.
I'm so proud of you. Compliments to you from all the people we meet. Yes, and I'm so proud.
I'm so proud.
Believe me, I love you too. I'm so proud of being loved.
I had to take you there, Grandmaster.
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah.
Started the show off with some really, really good love music, man, some soul. So I figured I'd dig in my dusties as well and break out a little Curtis.
Oh, that's beautiful, man. Curtis, I miss Curtis, too, man.
How can you not?
Curtis was, you know, for people who don't know, Curtis used to sing with a group called The Impressions, along with Jerry Butler was in that group as well. And, you know, when Curtis branched out by himself, he came up with Superfly. I'm going to make you my bye-bye.
Yeah, and baby. Changed the sound of soul.
Yes, he did.
Merging it with funk.
Yeah.
And R&B.
That's right.
Incredible album.
Yeah. And then Curtis was a very conscious writer. If you listen to, I would advise all of you listeners to get some Curtis Mayfield and listen to Curtis's, you know, anthology. Because it was on and cracking. You know, talking about Curtis, I have something to hit you with.
And we'll take that to the break as we get our brother.
Ibrahim.
Ibrahima has just entered right, the room, so yeah. We're going to bring him on. So give him a little something, a little traveling music while we go to the break.
I got it for him right here. Yes, indeedy. Here we go, y'all. Check this out. This is my baby here, boy. I love her.
Curtis Mayfield had his finger on the pulse of society. Even when we as a people did not know where we were going, Curtis musically led the way. One of my favorite parts in one of his songs said,
"People must prove to the people a better day is coming for you and for me." Choice of colors, which one would you choose, my brothers? If there were no day or night, which would you prefer to be right? I don't have hated your white teacher who told you to love your black preacher. With love for our nation, we'll make a better society. Now some of us would rather cuss and make a fuss,
oh yeah,
than to bring about a little trust. But we shall overcome.
We shall overcome.
I believe someday.
If you were only
to all I have to say, I won't have you hating your white.
Oh yeah, that's my baby Gladys. You know, we've been having some super dupers in here. You know, last week we had Lawrence Hilton Jacobs in and John Wilson from Sly Slick and the Wicked. Next week we have Earth, Wind, and Fire. And what I'm doing is I'm working on three young ladies. One is Chaka Khan, Shaka, my baby girl. And then also Aretha, based on her health. If we can, she will be in here. And then Gladys. I'm waiting on Gladys to get out on this end. And then if not, I'm going to get her to call in. And also, I'm waiting on Miss Abilene Champagne King. Yes, indeed. That's my little sweet baby. We came up in Philly when she was a little toddler thing. They used to call her Bubbles, and I know she hates to hear that name because I'm the only one out here that know that we used to call her that, that her name was Bubbles back in the day, you know, cause she was so bubbly, you know. But yeah, man, you know, the shows are going to be great coming in. We got some really, really extraordinary guests that are going to be visiting us. Everybody, for those of you who were not listening, you are who are just tuning in, you are listening to Jerry Bell's R&B Soul Classics on LATalkLive.com. You can call in at 323-247-7443 and get us online and ask any questions that you want, request any songs that you want. And if not, you know, sit back, kick back, relax, and listen to the smooth sounds of the soul music. I got my co-host here, Ibrahima. What's up, brother? Assalamu alaikum.
Waalaikumsalam. How you doing?
I'm good, brother. And brother Rich, we started our battle already. You know what I mean?
I was gonna say right back from the break, the official battle lines have been drawn. We are going to go impromptu today in a brief training session where the Grandmaster will get me better prepared for the bigger battle to come. But you know, I'm just gonna go blow for blow with him for a little bit. Little Earth, Wind, and Fire in the background from one of the greatest albums to me they ever made. Last Days and Times.
Oh, brother.
Woo! I'd Rather Have You. Can we give it a listen?
Yes, indeed.
Check it out.
Well, isn't my thing. I'd rather have you. Wealthy or not,
to get in on this one, man. Lord have mercy. And this particular version of it doesn't do it justice because I've had to pull this from YouTube. I have this original song, one of the greatest albums Earth, Wind & Fire ever made, man. And first of all, the love lyrics in here, the expression of love. And of course, Miss Jessica Cleaves.
Yes, indeed.
The songstress on that. Just makes this song. I mean, the lyrics alone are just amazing.
You know, give that. This song gives me the idea of the fifth dimension too.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Heavy influences, of course.
Yeah, man, I love it.
Everybody was making this kind of music. Let's look, give it a listen. Hold on, check it out.
I'm
Send me that note there, Jerry. It's a very different sound for Earth, Wind & Fire when you think of traditional Earth, Wind & Fire songs. Mm-hmm. And people go back to some of the more popish, I would say, music from the 80s and what have you.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But this was some real new, raw, original sound.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean.
How many songs did we get in this? We got a little jazz. We got a little R&B. We got this little jazzy thing going on here, a little bossa nova. Yeah, it's crazy.
And you know, this song reminds you of also, like, the Flower Child.
It was. That whole era.
It was like that, you know, mm-hmm. the Flower Child type of time that this came out. You know, psychedelic and the whole nine.
When you look at the album cover, you know, we talked about on a previous episode of your show how when you bought music back in the day, for example, the New Birth album cover that you have here in the background.
Where we were all naked.
You were all but naked, like the break of dawn.
Yeah, baby.
And not only would you get great music in these incredible albums, but you would get great artwork, some of which still stands the test of time, and that is truly one of them. On the cover of this album, you get that entire Flower Child thing, Last Days and Times. And there was so much great music from this album.
Yeah.
And this girl is blowing.
She
took
like
it all the way to the end, too.
She was like the young lady, Lonnie Wiggins, that was in our group, New Birth.
Exactly. Yeah. And they were fine sisters, too. These were some good-looking women.
With the afros? Yes, sir. Natural hair. You know what I mean?
Man, I'm telling you.
It was on and cracking. So, look, man, since you wanted to war with the Grandmaster...
Doom, doom, doom.
I think I'm going to have to hit you with something.
Uh-oh.
That's
a knockout right there. Hold on, let me see what this is.
Oh, that's me.
That you?
That's a dance band hit.
There you go.
Where did that come from?
All right, well, that's still playing on your joint. All right, I'm going to pull that down. All right,
so I'm going to hit you with something that I think is a monstrous type of hit. Oh, wait.
Oh, okay. A couple of false starts. That's okay, Grandmaster.
That's right. Yeah, that's
you're entitled to that.
Grandmaster got
Rufus.
He go put on my bell bottoms and platform shoes.
Yeah,
buddy. Okay, nice shot. Let's take this to the break.
That's my baby.
Enjoy this music.
Shock,
we'll
shock.
Back.
That's right.
Tell him what it is, Grandmaster.
This is Shaka Khan, baby. Love me, right? love you. Yeah, baby. This is the sounds of Chaka Khan and Rufus.
That's right.
That you're hearing in the background. You got the love. As a matter of fact, on bass is my main man, Bobby Watson, who we're going to have in the studio coming in to represent Rufus. And then Chaka Khan.
Okay, so as you might be listening, the Grandmaster has thrown down the gauntlet, and we're going to go blow for blow. Right now, we're going to take a little break, pay a few bills. He's going to give me an opportunity to come back and respond to that move he just put on me. That's kind of hardcore, you know, but I think I have something for you, Grandmaster. Okay. After the break, tell him what it is.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to Jerry Bell's R&B Soul Classics on LATalkLive.com. We are heard and seen worldwide, baby. You can reach us at 323-247-7443. Hit us. We love you. We'll be back. Stay tuned.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Are you ready to enjoy the Maui lifestyle? You can have it all by owning real estate on the Paradise Island of Maui. Dennis Rush, a 22-year Maui resident and real estate broker, brings his wealth of experience and market knowledge to add value to your Maui real estate understanding, providing a level of service as unique and exceptional as the island of Maui itself. The magical island of Maui was voted the most exclusive resort island in the world by Condé Nast Traveler, and keep in mind, Maui is only a simple non-stop flight away. Hawaii Business Magazine Top 100 Realtors awarded Dennis Rush the 2011 fourth top realtor on the island of Maui. Go to www.dennisrush.com to view all of the amazing properties currently available in the Maui MLS system. Whatever your needs or desires, Dennis Rush will provide a private consultation for any Maui properties your heart desires. You will be in good hands. Once again, go to www.dennisrush.com. That's www.dennisrush.com. Contact Dennis today to start your Maui lifestyle now. Dennis Rush, proud sponsors of the Dawn Christie Show and LA Talk Live.
You suffer from degenerative diseases such as high blood pressure, diabetes, fibroid tumors, high cholesterol, genital herpes, or a plethora of other diseases that rob you of a quality life? If so, then visit the website of herbalist Tahuti Ma'atra at dhealthstore.com and open the door to natural healing at an affordable price. dhealthstore.com has over 1,800 products created by herbalist Tahuti Ma'atra, specifically designed to help you heal the natural and safe way. At dhealthstore.com, you'll find everything from herbal formulas and cleanses, such as Tahuti's famous Full Body Detox, as well as herbal teas, extracts, natural body butters, lotions, creams, children's products, hair care products, and of course, sexual enhancement products for both men and women. So visit the website of Tahuti Ma'atra, dhealthstore.com, or call toll free at 1-888-823-9416. dhealthstore.com.
Welcome back to LATalkLive.com.
He hit you back with another shaka.
He's trying to strike hard. You know?
How am I doing, Grandmaster?
You're doing good.
I'm doing
good. I'm blocking you, but you're doing good.
I want some real talk. Listen, man. You being who you are, and often I've said about your show, you know, you want to tell people over and over again, at least in the first few weeks, who you are, who your co-host is, where you guys come from, your musical background, your musicology, the whole nine. I don't in any way suspect that I'm challenging your musicology, but it sure is fun. And I get to play some of my favorite hits because, you know, you inspire me.
Okay,
so you'll play a little something like, oh, okay. So, yeah. How you like this one?
Oh, I love it. I love it. It's good. You know, the main important thing, too, man, is that we have a chance to really play some real music for our listeners, you know, because there's so much – convoluted stuff that's out there. And a lot of people have complained, you know, about what is being...
What's on the radio.
Yeah.
Which is pure... I mean, no disrespect to all the other radio stations out there. It's just so junky.
Yeah. Well, you know the problem messy. The problem is that the powers that be control them, and they don't have the freedom to really do what they know that they should be doing. And this is where we come in, because it's good. I'm glad they like that so that we have the opportunity to blast.
That gives us our space. To shine.
Yes,
I do. I totally agree.
The only good radio I've really heard consistently
is our radio.
It's our radio. But I mean, been around the country, the radio stations in New Orleans.
Oh yeah.
Amazing. Amazing.
I hear that.
And they are very independent. They play what they want to play, and it's real people who appreciate music that are playing that music. And so it's,
you know, I talked to Jimmy Bohorn last night, and actually he wanted to call in, but he left this morning to go to Europe to do a television show. He was telling me that they just closed a radio station down in West Palm Beach that was giving a lot of soul and R&B. They just closed the radio station down, man, and now it makes it hard for the people there who like soul music to get any soul music. They have to tune into Miami to try to get any soul music. So I told them, you know, let the people know that they can call in and pull up LA Talk Live
or MiamiTalkLive.com as well. That's the thing. We have over nearly 30 different URL, aka web portals, through which people can access this very same programming.
Yeah.
So if you are a Heat lover and a Lakers hater, you ain't got to come to LA Talk Live. Go to Miami Talk Live. Right. You'll see the same great programming in your respective time zone. Right. So for all of those folks out there, you know, and this is what really I love about this show and this time slot. So it's 2 o'clock on the West Coast, you know. Let's see, 5 o'clock East Coast, and then whatever in between. So folks are just getting off work. And, you know, the bulk of our audience are mobile media consumers.
Right.
You feel me? They want mobile media. They're not stuck anywhere, don't want to be, and want to have their mobile or their media content on the go. So mobile media content consumers are our biggest audience.
Right, right.
So if you're back east, you're just getting in your car, you know, pull us up on your smartphone or your smart tablet.
That's right.
Pop in that little audio cable that connects to the in-car stereo, and you can be jamming to some of this great music you're bringing us. Yeah. But even here on the West Coast, Grandmaster Jerry, people are just coming back from lunch. And, you know, it's said that a lot of people get that 2 o'clock lunch lull, after lunch lull.
Right, right.
They kind of, oh, man, I can't wait till 5.
Right.
They can tune into this, even if you can't watch this, because some people are at work. Lots of them are. They're firewalled from getting to our site because of the video content. We don't do anything X-rated, just that the company don't want you watching us all day while you're supposed to be working.
Correct.
But they will allow you to download iTunes software, and embedded in iTunes software is iTunes Radio. Scroll on down to LA Talk Live in the soul R&B genre. And at this point in the day, it's hump day. Got all this great music and great R&B and soul, and people are like, you know, I can't imagine they're not thrilled to hear something different and unique.
Yeah.
You know, satellite radio, they do what they do. No diss to them. AM and FM, they do what they do. No diss to them. And there's thousands of other internet radio stations throughout the country. But the one thing about internet radio, internet broadcasting, that makes all of us different, and big ups to all of the independent internet broadcasters out there, is that we say what we want, but we play what you want. You feel me?
That's right.
And playing some of the great R&B classics, like with this show, Jerry Bell's R&B Soul Classics, every Wednesday at 2 p.m., 2 to 4, for all of those who are just tuning in, it's a two-hour show.
Yeah.
And we get to play some great music. And today is a very special episode.
That's right.
Because we're featuring the music today.
Yes, indeed.
Let's welcome our good friend, Brother Brahima.
Yeah, brother.
They've been looking at you for the longest.
Soul power.
Soul power.
What's up, brother?
I'm doing well, brother. How are you?
Good. Oh, man, I can't complain. You know, I had a very interesting weekend. You know, we did the martial arts seminar. Mm-hmm. And I want to give a shout out, actually, to my organization, which is two of them. One is the Black Rue organization that's out in Riverside, California. For those of you who would like to train in the martial arts, you can find us out there. You can talk to my partner, Terrell Johnson. They call him Big T, and he runs the organization. Very fine out there.
Also to my Sanukis Rue family all over on the East Coast, the West Coast, Philadelphia, Detroit, Chicago, New York, you know, Baltimore, D.C., Florida. You know, we're all over. We have a large organization. Plus, we're also in the Caribbean islands. And then the Black Rue organization is in Africa as well. So, you know, we're giving a shout out to everybody there. Lisa LaRue. I told her I'd holler at her. You know what I mean? Yeah. So I'm hollering at you. I'm giving you your 2 minutes of fame, baby. The weekend was good. I did the seminar. It was good. But he gonna hit me with soul power now. You know, okay, so I had to throw my
I served at your behest, friend master.
I had to throw my block.
Yeah,
up.
I did try to blindside him. I tried to cold cock him. Hey, look at that all day. You're not watching. Let me see if I can find you.
That's all right. But y'all listening, look, you know, I wish I had
just a little background music. Let's keep
that's good. I wish I had the photos too, man. Of when I spent a lot of time with James, and James was just like everybody, like Michael's favorite. You know, he was the man. And if it were not for the James Browns and the Jackie Wilsons, there would be no really soul funk. James was the funky man, you know. But I had an opportunity to spend time with James Brown and work with James and be on tour, you know, on some of the stuff with the JBs and Fred Wesley. Bootsy Collins, you know, which Bootsy was his baddest bass player that he's ever had. And, you know, Mousy, one of James's drummers. And, I mean, just an incredible group of people, you know. Bobby Bird, who actually Bobby Bird was one of the Famous Flames, and Bobby Bird introduced me to James. And then Bobby had a lot of hit records out, and if you hear you can hear Bobby Bird in the background with James Brown, like, "Come back for more," you know. He was always that sidekick with James. And the times, man, it's just, oh my God, and the dancing and the different movements, you know, was just on and cracking. I missed it. I miss JB. I miss Michael. As a matter of fact, the week after we have Earth, Wind & Fire on, I'm going to have the drummer from Guns N' Roses on here with us.
Heard that.
And he was very, very close friends with Mike. And he and I used to talk to Mike at 3 o'clock in the morning. So we're going to have that discussion about Michael so we can break the thing that people have put out about Michael Jackson.
Sure. All the myth.
Yeah, all the
misconceptions,
myth.
The lies.
Yes, yes. So we want to be able to touch up on that situation, on that subject, and let people know that Michael was a beautiful human being, and he had no parts in pedophiling or any of that stuff. Mm-hmm. My sons, when they were little boys, even spent time at Neverland Ranch with Mike and the kids, and hung out, you know, and just, you know, had a blast, man. So we're gonna touch that up, you know.
I'm glad to hear that too, Grandmaster, and a round of applause for you in restoring Michael Jackson's great legacy, his work, his charity to the children, all the great things that he did, because it's so frequent that we see the powers that be, and I don't want to get into finger pointing, name calling, none of that stuff, but always demonizing our heroes.
Yeah.
You know, no less so now than it was back in the days when Martin Luther King himself was demonized and accused to have been a womanizer.
Right.
If for no other reason, just to stain his name.
Right. Well, let me
it's great to see that people like yourself are going to come out and remove these.
Right. And let me touch lies on that too. When they say, you know, about Martin Luther King being a womanizer, we are men.
Well, that's first.
And it's a good thing that we do love women, because the stuff that's going on
today. That's a good thing.
the things that's happening today with the male population.
Well, let's talk about the Catholic Church, but I don't want you to get off track. We can come back to that topic. Good Lord. Yeah. They ought to be shamed of their goddamn selves.
Yeah, exactly.
And I did say goddamn. Yes, I'm sorry, God. But they ought to be shamed of their
damn selves. Well, that's goddamned behavior. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
That it is.
Yeah.
That it is.
You know, so, I mean, those type of things, they have no room to speak on the great kings and queens that we are. You know, I mean, there is no room for them to even make a comment about us on anything because we are great at what we do. We have been the greatest at what we do, and we will continue to do that. We continue to overshadow and leaps and bounds of whatever have come before us from the beginning of time. So, you know, I really want to have that dialogue about the Michael and what Michael's legacy was and what he really loved and what he wanted to, and for those of people who don't know, Michael was a great artist as well.
Hmm. He was a great painter.
Yeah. Right. He was like a Michelangelo.
He's a Renaissance man.
Yeah. This cat was, he reminds me of myself.
Ah, that's right. Exactly. Because you in fact are a painter as well.
Yes, indeed.
And a painter of some greatness.
Yeah.
To which extent, I will not hazard a guess, but I actually am the proud owner of one of your pieces that we're going to be getting framed and hanging proudly here in our studios here at LA Talk Live. Yeah. Thank you for that.
Oh,
very much so.
Thank you. Yeah, indeed. Man. It was my pleasure. I mean, I think that, you know, we are creators of things, and some people call it arrogance. It's just reassurance. You know, we know who we are and what we are and why we are. and Mike was one of those people. He was a very soft individual where, you know, I think I might come over a little harder because I'm more stern on how I feel about, you know, dealing with people and things because of the avenues that I have had to come up on. Mike was basically, Joseph sheltered Mike a great deal. He protected him.
And I was going to ask, Grandmaster, because of your close connections to the Jackson family, once again, thank you for bringing in Lawrence Hilton Jacob last week, an incredible actor.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't even know, and I remember saying this last week, and it rang in my head for that entire time. I said, wow, you guys sitting up here talking about, calling him, saying, hey, Larry, 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 as if he isn't the great Lawrence Hilton Jacobs.
Right.
And the role he played, of course, in the Jackson family movie. But let's talk a little bit about your close relationship to Michael. And the question I wanted to pose was whether you thought that it was in, with great wealth and success comes tremendous and even greater sometimes responsibility and burdens.
Right.
And here's this young man who, from the time he was a young child, and I remember so clearly in my head the day that the Jackson 5 music started rolling out to the public. I want to be your sugar daddy, all of that, and ABC. It was, I mean, wow. And we were like Justin Bieber fans for Michael Jackson all the way back, what, 30, nearly 40 years ago now.
Mm-hmm.
To have lived a privileged life as he lived, I think his softer side came from a sense of humility, but that was instilled through him through his power, his sense of self-power, how he really understood how the Creator had empowered him tremendously with the ability to touch millions and millions of lives through his work, his legacy, his music.
Right.
So I would think, now, I've never, and don't even know that I want to be that successful, that you really kind of got to go so deep inside, almost to a Zen state, almost to a Buddha state, to find this other persona of oneself, you know, like the great Mahatma Gandhi, like the great Dalai Lama, humble people, super humble.
Right.
You know, do you think that was part of what he had to go through?
Well, you know,
to live with all of that wealth and fame all that time had to be a tremendous burden.
One of the things that I tell everybody to look at, I go to a biblical stance on this, whereas Moses, Musa, in the beginning, when they tried to kill him and he was a baby. And it's the same, the jealousies that you don't even see, that people don't recognize, that are there, but they are there. People are very, I have no idea where this comes from. It's a demonic type of a force that moves through certain entities on the planet. I call it invasion of the body snatchers where they just hate you. People hate you for the color of your skin. They hate you.
Like I picked it.
You know what I mean?
I didn't pick this color.
They hate you if you have more money than they do. They hate you for the abilities that you have.
Hey, hell, they hate me because I'm good looking.
Yeah. You know?
Hey, hold on now.
You know what I'm saying? So with Michael, they saw the things that Mike could do that they had envy. And the powers that be, they could not fathom doing the things that Michael was capable of doing. There are two people on this planet. One still exists that had the ability. If you went into the Belgium Congo in the deep jungle, they knew two names.
Hmm.
Michael Jackson.
You know what I'm saying?
And Muhammad Ali.
You know what I'm saying, brother?
You know what I mean? Yeah. All over the globe, in every nook and cranny, these two names were known. And they did things that presidents of the United States couldn't do.
Mm.
You know, when they started looking at Michael as this young, vibrant, well-knowledgeable young man, young king, that had the ability, when he went into different countries just to perform or to visit, they would meet him not with the police. They met him with military in full regalia. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They greeted him like he was the prince who he really is. And the powers that be hated that. Michael was in control of his own life, of his own destiny. His love within inside of him, which was so spiritual, brought
so
about
connected to the divine.
Yeah, man, it just brought about, if you listen to his music, every piece of music that he's ever done has been based on something that has to do with life, with love, and integrity. His music was had so much integrity to it, and nothing in it was vulgar.
Mm.
You know, I mean, nothing, zero.
Mm-hmm.
Everything that he had to say was based on bringing the world together, children, loving someone. Even when he was doing "I Want You Back," ABC. ABC was learning, was teaching kids to learn the ABCs, you know what I mean? They were learning songs.
As evidenced by the fact that they turned it into a children's Saturday morning cartoon that used those same lyrics.
Yeah.
That's how I know how to count and spell now.
Yeah. And then when he did "I Want You Back," he sang love songs, but he sang them in a way of it had no sexual connotations to
exactly
it, you know what
nothing.
I mean, everything with him was very
pure,
you know, and the people didn't like that. And then others who were around him who they were in for getting whatever they can get out of Mike, you know. A lot of people have a lot to say about Joseph. Now let me tell you about Joseph. I'm a father and I'm hard on mine. When I have my kids with me, I'm real hard on them. And I have my oldest son to this day right now. He's angry with me because of, you know, the distance between he and I in the music situation. And he's a musician. I mean, he's a singer. But my thing is, you want it, you earn it. You don't get it for free. You earn it. And I tell all my children the same thing. And I'm real hard on them. I'm martial art hard on them. You know, and Joseph was like that. You know, and this is what formed and made
the
them
men
to be
the men.
Yes.
Because Michael and I are about the same age. Had he still been living, the men that we are now.
That's right.
You know what I mean? More self-reliant.
And there would be no
more dignity about ourselves. Yeah. You know,
there would be no Jermaines and Tito's and Jackie's and Marlins and Janet's. And, you know, there would be no Latoya's. And if all of them would have stayed under the protection of their father.
Mm.
See, that's the problem. The society started intervening and deciding, you know, from the bad press of the powers that be, because they had the money to put it out there, to make it look what it wasn't. you know, and to put it out there and to make it seem as though that Joe was this heathen, crazy, crazed individual that
pedophilic type individual, because then you got, you know, LaToya out there telling, oh, he touched me, all that nonsense.
But, you know, in that interim too is, you know, the powers that be got involved, got into that, into that family situation and got to the girls, which are, no disrespect to the women, but the women are the weaker vessels. And so because of that, they move on emotions. They don't move like men. Men move on what we see is what it is and how we're going to deal with it. Women are very emotional. They have that motherly instinct. So you get somebody to come along with some slick talk. Yeah, baby, let me talk to you for a second.
Sure.
You know, look, I know you're going through changes. And they catch them when they're going through their
mental
cycle.
You don't need your daddy no more.
Yeah.
You don't need Joe.
Yeah.
I can make you a bigger star and chief a lot.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
You know, and so falling for that and then getting caught up in the head trip. And then the dude that was with her.
Oh, what a low life.
He could put fear in her.
Right.
You know, I got a call from the brothers and the brothers and Jermaine and Tito was like, hey man, we need you to step into this situation for us because this is out of hand. You know, the same thing with the death of Marlon's wife. You know, I mean, there are many different avenues that's caught up in this whole thing where people see money and they see greed and they are coming at you. And if you don't have that protection, if you don't have that protection, everybody else outside of your family, forget about it. Mm. They're speculative. If you don't have the protection of your father, your mom can only do so much. Daddy is the man. Daddy is the man. And for those women who are single parents and, you know, you don't have the man around in various situations, it's understandable. But when the man wants to be around, you should not cut his testicles from being there. You should allow him to be there so that he can
not
a boy cannot be a man without a father.
That's right.
I don't care how much motherly whatever a mom is, he still needs to have his daddy. And if his daddy is there and willing and wanting to, it's not about the money. It's about what's going to happen with my son 25 years from now when I'm an old woman and he is out here. Is he going to be in the penitentiary? Is he going to be in a gang? Is he going to get killed? Is he going to be a homosexual? What is he going to be? I got to have him around his father. That is the answer. And that was the problem with the Jackson family. The powers that be were able to move Joe out because they knew they couldn't get to him.
Marginalize him by making him look like a madman.
Brother, let me tell you something. It was hard for me to get on the Havenhurst compound. You couldn't get on that compound, man. You know what I mean?
Well, I know I couldn't get on that.
And then
you
Joe
had to remind me, Grandmaster. Look, I knew
even,
I couldn't.
Even with the security that was there, Joe was like, who is this? Who's this person? You know what I mean? Who are you? I don't know you.
Mm.
You can't talk to my son. You can't talk to my daughters. He was like that. And I know I'm the same way. It's like, who is this person? Who are you touching my kid? Who are you? I don't know you. Don't put your hands on my kid. You know,
I'm the same way. I've got a beautiful 2-year-old.
Yeah, man.
Pretty little young fella.
Yeah.
And cute as he can be.
You know, the,
you know, his mother wants to get him in Hollywood.
No, that's a no.
I was watching this show on one of the cable channels, you know, one of the like HBO type cable channels. Yeah. Wasn't HBO, though. And they had this good looking young dude. You could tell he was, you know, probably in his late teens, early 20s. In a very sexually compromising position.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what his sexual orientation is, I don't know. But when, and this was one of the first times I turned this show on because I'd heard so much about it and it's gotten rave reviews. I turned the show on and it starts with this incredibly, I just was blown away. I'm like, wow, this is what they can show at prime time in this sexual situation where this young dude was in. With another guy on top of that. And I said to myself, wow, now, if you're a straight actor out here, to be asked to play that role just to get into a major primetime cable TV show would have to, at least in my opinion, in my experience, be incredibly debilitating mentally and spiritually because that's given up so much of yourself to play that role. Now, if that gentleman, that young brother was in that lifestyle, then that's one thing. But just looking at the way they portrayed it and there were two or three guys in this particular scene. And I said to myself, oh, my God. And is my son is probably one of the smartest babies I've ever come across. And I've been on the planet long enough and met enough babies. Mm-hmm. And had enough baby mama drama. Anyway, but he's one of the most intelligent, good-looking kids. You know, when I look at him, I often think about the impression you made on me, Grandmaster Bell, when you first walked into my business establishment some years ago, and you had these two beautiful young brothers with you.
My twins.
Who he had doubled down on and had twins with. It's one thing to have one. You doubled down and got two of them. And I remember how striking that image was. But when I look at my son now and think about what Hollywood has to offer and the opportunities they might present to him and the challenges.
Right.
And the crossroads.
Yeah.
I'm like, nah. Yeah. I better get him into some education. I'm
sorry. Hollywood is a
it's demonized.
It's a
bitch. Let's keep it real.
It's a beast.
I love you, Hollywood. And but you're a pretty bitch.
There's a, you know, and it's just like Hollywood itself, right? Like people come to this country thinking, oh, I'm going to see Hollywood and it's going to be amazing and beautiful. And they get there and it goes, ooh, it's kind of a dingy, dirty city with all kinds of horrible things. That's the business. You know, it, at the end of the day, it is a business. And also, too, it's a business that has a lot of power because it's dealing with perceptions and people's beliefs and views and whatnot. And it can guide and direct those beliefs and views. And what comes with power, you know,
is a great responsibility.
Great responsibility. Now, you know, that's a term that's thrown around. It's almost cliche. But, you know, the Africans, for example, before the reason why African education is so initiatory is because the whole point about it is that you're supposed to build character before you get access to power. And because the idea is that the more power
that was so heavy. I hope that didn't go over the listener's head.
Because the more
build character,
the more power you have, the more character is required. Because you have to know when to wield it, how to wield it, because power is a tool. And it can be just as easily used for good and it can be abused for bad. And there's a lot of things that go on in this town because of the abuse of power. And I'm always, I cringe when I see these parents throwing their children into this. And one of the things that I've always applauded about Joe Jackson, even when I was younger, and there were all the bad press was about him. My father used to applaud him. He protected his family as best he could. And because it was almost overnight. They went from going to projects, living in the projects, to being the family that everybody knew, and all of this stuff coming at you right away. As a father, I don't know. I mean, if I were a father, I have no idea how I would deal with that.
He's just a regular dad.
Yeah.
But let me tell you, a regular working man.
But see, the thing about that, too, is I'm in Hollywood. I'm in this madness. Fortunately, I've had the opportunity through family members and through the people that I came up with, like the Gambling Huffs and that genre, that gave me a sense of knowing and seeing all the things, and it was a protection.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I was very well disciplined, you know, not to get involved and get caught up in the madness. And it's gotten worse in these years. I'm telling you, I would tell any parent, keep your sons away from the industry, especially from the movie industry, because if they're not homosexuals, they will be, because they'll turn you out. And this is the thing that the powers that be that control Hollywood, or most of them are caught up in it. And I hate to put it like that, but that's the truth.
And for the sake of clarification, if that is your choice of lifestyle, you know, we have to acknowledge, especially nowadays, that it is what it is. Let's put it like that.
Well,
and there are people of other sexual orientations who broadcast with us.
Yeah.
And I don't want to put the word out that we are in any way judgmental about that.
You know what?
But I'd like to say that, you know, and we got to go to break, Brahima. Yeah. And I actually want to come back from the break and get you on the mic more.
Okay.
I think I've been talking too much, but I just want to say, you know, that is your choice. And that's the choice of a lifestyle. And I don't want to ostracize any of our broadcasters.
Right. But no, what I'm saying, the only thing I'm saying about it is I'm talking about the youth.
I think and the corruption there.
Yeah, the youth, you know, have the youth,
corruption of their morals.
Right, the youth have no. I mean, you know, they're so small that they don't have the opportunity to think for themselves. They just go by what they see.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. And so this is where a parent is important. Where both mother and father is important. Whether you're together or you're not, you know, this is where it's important. And I think this is how what they were trying so hard to do was to get Joseph away from Michael so that they could just turn Michael into whatever they wanted to turn him into.
And I think Frankie Lyman is a classic example.
Yes, indeed.
Of what happens
yep.
when they're able to get their hands on him.
And then on this note before we go out.
Frankie was straight.
Before we go out on this note, Michael defeated them at their own game.
Sure did.
Because Mike was a brilliant, brilliant businessman. Mm. And he defeated them and they hated him for that. They hate him because they're so used to getting you. He got them. I love it.
Now, Grandmaster, I have to say, I know this is completely unfair for me to shoot this little jab at you while we go to the break. But you were talking about Michael Jackson and one of my favorite Michael Jackson songs.
So I'm going to come back on you with some.
Okay. All right. So let's take us to the break, Grandmaster.
You are listening to the sounds of Michael, the great King Jackson. And you are listening on LATalkLive.com. Please call in 323-247-7443. Voice your opinions. Ask for request or what have you. We love you and we love to hear from you. Peace.
Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.
Do you suffer from degenerative diseases such as high blood pressure, diabetes, fibroid tumors, high cholesterol, genital herpes, or a plethora of other diseases that rob you of a quality life? If so, then visit the website of herbalist Tahuti Ma'atra at dhealthstore.com and open the door to natural healing at an affordable price. dhealthstore.com has over 1,800 products created by herbalist Tahuti Ma'atra, specifically designed to help you heal the natural and safe way. At dhealthstore.com, you'll find everything from herbal formulas and cleanses, such as Tahuti's famous Full Body Detox, as well as herbal teas, extracts, natural body butters, lotions, creams, children's products, hair care products, and of course, sexual enhancement products for both men and women. So visit the website of Tahuti Ma'atra, dhealthstore.com, or call toll free at 1-888-823-9416. dhealthstore.com.
Are you ready to enjoy the Maui lifestyle? You can have it all by owning real estate on the Paradise Island of Maui. Dennis Rush, a 22-year Maui resident and real estate broker, brings his wealth of experience and market knowledge to add value to your Maui real estate understanding, providing a level of service as unique and exceptional as the island of Maui itself. The magical island of Maui was voted the most exclusive resort island in the world by Condé Nast Traveler, and keep in mind, Maui is only a simple non-stop flight away. Hawaii Business Magazine Top 100 Realtors awarded Dennis Rush the 2011 fourth top realtor on the island of Maui. Go to www.dennisrush.com to view all of the amazing properties currently available in the Maui MLS system. Whatever your needs or desires, Dennis Rush will provide a private consultation for any Maui properties your heart desires. You will be in good hands. Once again, go to www.dennisrush.com. That's www.dennisrush.com. Contact Dennis today to start your Maui lifestyle now. Dennis Rush, proud sponsors of the Dawn Christie Show and LA Talk Live. Hey, this is Richard Carr, General Manager for LA Talk Live and host of the New Entrepreneurs Weekly Summit. I wanted to take a moment out to welcome one of my newest sponsors, and that is Sensational Soaps. Sensational Soaps are handmade with all natural ingredients, with absolutely no preservatives, no harsh chemicals, and of course, no animal testing. Your body will look and feel silky, smooth, moisturized, and completely revived. Do you suffer from dry, ashy skin? Then layer your skin with their luxurious blend of oils and shea butters specially formulated to revive dry, dull skin. Sensational Soaps also offers a full line of bath and body products, including luxurious bath salts and body scrubs, massage oils and lip balms, even romantic gift sets and custom gift baskets for your lover or significant other. For more information or to place an order, visit them at www.sensationalsoaps.biz. That's www.sensationalsoaps.biz. Sensational Soaps. Pamper yourself and indulge your senses. Sensationalsoaps.biz. Proud sponsors of LA Talk Live and the New Entrepreneurs Weekly Summit.
That is the sounds, ladies and gentlemen, of the Daz Band, the Kinsmen Daz, y'all. This is, that's funny, this is a song that was produced and written by Ralph Johnson and Philip Bailey from Earth, Wind, and Fire. It was the first Daz Band hit.
Oh, it has that Earth, Wind, and Fire feel
yes,
to
indeed,
it.
Yeah, man, you know, probably back in the day. And actually, that was my first introduction to the Daz Band, was through Philip and Ralph. At that particular time, too.
So, you know, okay. First, welcome back to the Jerry Bell's R&B Soul, R&B Soul Classic Show, with your host Jerry Bell
and
co-host Brahima Salam. I am your humble engineer, Richard Carr. And you know, Grandmaster, it is not at all fair to take me into deep waters so soon in my training. But you know, I'm going to do the best I can.
He's and, also.
I was staggered. I was on one knee, wiped the blood off my of the corner of my jaw. Like, okay.
Hey, listen. I want to give a shout out to Michael Calhoun. Michael Calhoun was the actually a founder of the Kinsmen Daz Band, and fortunately, we have recovered the name. He has recovered the name of the Kinsmen Daz Band. Back because it was out and some other people had it and had Daz Band kind of locked down and had people fooled. And so Michael Calhoun has gotten the name trademarked. So we're getting ready to do some major things together. And actually, we've just been inducted into the R&B Hall of Fame.
Nice.
And on that same day, Michael Jackson has been re-inducted into the R&B Hall of Fame.
Wow. So.
Which is May 5th, Cleveland, Ohio, you guys. Yeah. It's a beautiful thing, man. Love it, love it, love it. So I hit you there and you kind of breathless, huh?
No, actually, Grandmaster, I'm not.
He's going to try to come back on you. I love it.
You want to play this or just let it be some background music? Because I want to bring Brother Brian on.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, ain't that something?
Oh, man.
Oh, boy.
Am I worthy, Grandmaster?
Almost.
Musically, you're getting there. Getting there. I had to go ahead and drop that on you, man. Call a little melon, Tim. Anyway, welcome, Brother Brahima.
Good to be welcome.
Indeed.
Yeah, my brother. So how you feel, man? What you think? What you think about this war that's going on here?
It's pretty cool. You guys are keeping it pretty mellow, though, I've noticed.
Well, you know, I'm following the Grandmaster.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm following his fighting style. You know,
I'm finna hit him with something, though.
See, I'm not a Grandmaster, but I do understand the idea of allowing his aggression to work in my behalf.
But, yeah, see,
I think I have to hit him with the death blow.
What you got queued up?
All right, so
maggot brain.
Just
run right into the funk, huh?
He's gonna take it to the ground. Now it's a ground fight.
I'm just playing.
Don't make me pull out my
Mac
and Brain.
Oh,
I got some.
Are you ready for this one?
All right, okay. All right, come on.
Ladies and gentlemen, here we go. We're going to hit him with something real hot.
Oh, yeah. In the place to be.
I'm in deep water. I'm going to tell you already.
Oh, okay.
Oh, this is for all the players. All the money makers. From the East Coast to the West Coast.
This is a Daz band. Although it was Brick, this is Daz band.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Music makes your body move.
Well, all right.
Baby. All right, so Grandmaster, you got to help me on this one, man. Yes, okay, I'm in the corner. My cut man working on me. Kind of lumped up right now with this one. But I've often wondered, you know, particularly with this, with Brick doing Doozik, you know, where's that connection coming from? Now, this is Daz. I mean, you know, you got Doozik,
yeah,
right? And this is not Doozik. This is a, right?
Right.
What's the name of the song?
This is Disco Daz.
Disco Daz. And then you had Doozik.
Doozik,
from Brick.
Right.
Any connection there between the bands?
Yeah, well, Disco Daz belonged to, it was actually originally a Brick song. And then we recorded. We redid the whole song.
Word.
Yeah.
So this is a cover. In other words, more or less. Yeah. Okay.
And then we put a little rap on it, and, you know, that kind of thing.
So a recent remix.
Yeah, it's been some years though. It's been about maybe 10 years. And actually, the gentleman that's doing the rap on it, I want to give a big shout out to his family. His name is Terry Stanton. Terry was murdered. In 2002, unfortunately, right after we had did a concert in Vegas, and we were coming back from Las Vegas, and he decided to go to an after-hour joint and never returned, you know.
Mm.
But that's him in the background.
So, gents, before the break, and I wanted to get Brahima to weigh in on this as well. What's going on in the music industry? We know that there is a lot of corruption, a lot of twisted stuff going on in the music game. Recently, Clive Davis came out to the public that he was in the lifestyle.
Mm. He's always been in the lifestyle.
Right. And very often, I've wondered, as a layman, a regular guy, you know, how does one go from one lifestyle to the next and exchange that just for a big paycheck? You know, like, why is this so rampant, first of all, in the industry? And how can you bring a person who has lived this one lifestyle all their lives, into some other foreign lifestyle just based on a check? But with the outing, or the self-outing of Clive Davis, and despite all of the comments and, you know, urban myth, urban legend, or truth that I would hear people say about the music business, I still resisted the notion that there were people who'd be willing to sacrifice and give up their morality just to be famous and rich.
Well, I mean, if I can come in on this one. There's a thing about, I've never really concerned myself with what people do sexually in their private lives.
Yeah,
I could care
it's
less.
Their business.
But my main concern revolved around, there's a real problem. I mean, I don't know if you ever saw the interview. It's not really one that's talked about much, but on national television, Corey Haim and that one other child actor that they were close friends together, they were talking together.
The Coreys, I guess.
Yeah, the Coreys. Corey Feldman and Corey Haim, right? So they were talking to each other, and they talked about the fact that when they got in the industry, that they were both repeatedly
bombarded.
Sexually, not just sexually molested, but essentially raped.
Are you serious?
Yeah. And that it was such, he said the individuals were high up in the industry. Yeah. And that they approached the whole thing, it was very much a power thing. It was them saying, I can do this because I can. It was all an acting out of power. And one of the things they talked about is they said it's an undercurrent in the culture that there are people of power who go after young boys, young girls, and just turn them out because they look at it like, these are my possessions to have.
Let me.
And that is really what we're talking about. And if you don't have, like Jerry was talking about earlier, a good family around you, good parents that are protecting you from that madness, you will run. Because what child could really go up against that? Really?
Let me say this.
Before you do, Grandmaster, if I may, I'm not sure if you guys heard about this ignorant comment made on The Onion by one of their reporters about the young girl, Evagene, I forget her last name. She was in a movie called Beasts of the Southern Wild or something like that.
Yes.
Where someone wrote, I don't even want to repeat. I'm not going to repeat it.
Okay.
You know, I'm going to bear my responsibility as a broadcaster and not repeat what they said. But it was one of the most ignorant comments I'd heard made, and this little girl is like 9 years old, and someone used a sexual epithet, if you might, towards her, meaning that it was both sexual and negative, and began with the word C, saying that she's a little C, if you think about it. And this was posted on The Onion.
Wow.
Now, did y'all hear about this?
No, I didn't hear about that.
Wow.
Let me say this.
Go ahead.
This is for radio listeners around the world
and viewers because we're on Ustream.tv.
And to anybody else that, you know, is taking view or listening to this, from my standpoint of view, anyone, any male, any female that put their hands on my children, I will find you and I will kill you. That's the bottom line.
Yeah.
That's how I feel about it. Now, any other parent who don't go by that, I don't know what something's wrong with them.
You know,
you put your hands on mine, it's death.
When I was young, I remember I wanted really badly to be an actor because I wanted to be those. Because I grew up in the age of those child stars, right? So I wanted to be one of them, you know. I really wanted to be a Jedi more than anything, but
and you became one.
Exactly. Yeah. Ironically, but
careful what you want.
Exactly. Through a totally different avenue.
I get it.
But the thing that was and all the responsibility that comes with it. But the thing that was interesting is I remember one time when I was young, I got this audition that was going on, and I went there. My mother, cajoled my mother into taking me there. And when I got there, you know, it's some madness was going on. It's a circus. And it was a lot of kids there, a lot of kids with their parents and their mothers. And then at some point when it was all over, my mother took me to the side and she said, listen, if this is something you really want to pursue, then you're going to have to pursue it. But I want nothing to do with that madness that was going on there. The mothers pretty much thrusting their children into this to try to get them
feeding
famous.
Them as sacrificial lambs
exactly
to the altar.
And some of these parents will do anything to and sometimes that anything is casting a blind eye to what they know is going on so that their children can famous so they can vicariously live through them. And that was something my mother didn't want to be a part of. She said, I will support you in your pursuit of what you're doing. You got to be serious about it and you got to get it, but I'm going to be a part of that world.
Your mother and knew the battle ahead.
Exactly.
To protect you.
She knew what time it was.
To protect you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, let me say this. For me, morally, it is extremely important what we teach our children and how we have them and where we have them at and what we have them around, as well as for your own self. Mm-hmm. Your own self grow. I mean, you know, how do you grow up and become into an adulthood and face yourself in the mirror? I got a text from somebody that said, "I can't believe that you said," what did they say here? They said, "I can't believe that you made the gay comments." Well, believe it, because this is the real life. It's like they're untouchable. You know what I mean? They can't nobody say anything about them. That's like talking about Jewish. You know what I mean? Hmm. I say what it is. I mean what I say. And I speak my mouth. I speak my truth. And I speak what's in my head. And no one can stop that. I'm not afraid of anybody and anything. I'm not afraid of the industry. No one controls Jerry Bell. I control me. And I don't bow down to anyone but Allah. So, you know what I mean? It is what it is. I speak what is fact. And that's what's happening in this vast thing that we're involved in, and people are afraid to stand up.
Well, the late comedian Patrice O'Neill made a great comment when he was asked about many of the things that people have been saying and they had to apologize for.
I won't apologize for anything.
And the thing that he was frustrated with was he said, "I'm getting tired of hearing all these people apologize, saying something and then caught saying it and then saying I apologize." He said, "They said it. They obviously meant it
right.
When they said it. Why are they apologizing for how they really feel?"
Right.
He said, "The problem today is that we've lost context. Right. Nothing can be." So, for example, like what you said earlier, if a big media outlet wanted to, they could take what you said and then say, "Jerry Bell, gay bashing, talking about homosexuals on the air, da 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 da." And the reality was, is you were talking about homosexuality in the context of older men in the industry taking advantage of younger boys, which goes on and is deplorable.
It goes on in the churches too.
It goes on in churches.
So-called Christians.
And so but that's the problem, is that people, we are in a society that does not take context into regard. And so many things are blown completely out of context. Like, and Patrice O'Neill was responding, actually, now that I think about it, to that comedy piece that was done by Tracy Morgan.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember when I heard all the hoopla about Tracy Morgan said, you know, things about gay people. And I always have this, I don't make an opinion about something until I've looked up on it.
Right.
So I watched his comedy piece. And then afterwards, you know, a friend of mine would say, "What do you think about it?" I said, "Well, I didn't like it because it was a bad comedy bit. Like, it wasn't funny. But nothing he said was offensive." And he said that if his son came home and he was gay, he'd kill him. I said, "That's out of context. That's how the media took it out of context. That's not what he was saying. He was speaking with sarcasm. He was speaking sardonically."
Well,
and everyone who was present knew that. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was saying basically, "I don't see what the big deal with, you know, people have all this big deal about homosexual stuff." Like they said, you know, for me, for example, if my son came home and he was gay, I'd kill him. When he made that comment, he was being flippant. He was being funny. He was making a sarcastic remark.
Right.
It wasn't a good joke. It wasn't funny. But they crucified him as if. Now, Patrice O'Neill's point was, Tracy Morgan operates under the auspices of people who are in the SNL world. And that SNL world is very gay dominant.
Right.
And so knowing this, he should have known that he has to tread lightly with that.
Mm.
And what he basically did is he set himself up to be, they were like, "Oh, you owe us now. We're gonna make you pay us back big time." Mm. And that's what it is. I mean, at the end of the day, people get hooked in. I mean, this Hollywood is a collection of different groups and different forces. I mean, like, for example, Eddie Murphy is very much involved with high-powered Jews.
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean that they're insidious? No, these are individuals who have money, they have power, they have their own agendas, they have their own things. And Eddie Murphy is a part of that because Eddie Murphy knows that world. He speaks Yiddish. He comes from New York. He grew up around Jews. He knows that culture very well. I, in my dealings with Jews, have seen them express a great deal of admiration for Eddie Murphy. Mm-hmm. I remember saying one time to a Jewish producer, I said, is it true Eddie Murphy speaks Yiddish? And he paused and went, his diction and his grammar is almost perfect. He said he speaks it like a native-born speaker.
Right.
And he had admiration for Eddie Murphy. So there's a lot of respect that they, and he deals with very high-powered individuals who are Jewish.
Right.
That is the industry. It's the groups of people that you involve yourself with. Now, if Eddie Murphy came out and made a bunch of jokes about Jews that were in poor taste, he'd be setting himself up for some backlash.
But you know it. You know the problem. The thing is that, see, these people are indebted to whomever it is, the powers that be, or somebody that they're working for, or someone that they live with. I'm not indebted to anybody. I could give a damn. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I'm going to say what I mean. Mm-hmm. And no one can make me, I don't bite my tongue, I don't stutter. And no one can make me take back what I say. I said it, and I meant it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And I'm not afraid of being put an army in front of me. I'm still going to say the same thing. You can only kill me one time. Or try to. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I have no fears. And that's the problem with the people in this society, especially here in America. It's supposedly a free country, but everyone's all caught up in, oh, I can't say this because, well, I might lose my job, or, you know, they may not patronize me. Well, if you don't patronize me, I don't care. Mm-hmm. And it's not for you to.
And you're getting to what I think something that was voiced by Patrice O'Neill and by Dave Chappelle when he was talking about racism.
Yeah.
And even Paul Mooney, when what's his name? Who was the comedian?
Eddie Griffin?
No. The comedian who went off on stage at the Laugh Factory.
Oh, yeah. I know you're talking about Seinfeld guy.
Yeah. When he went off, I watched it. I was astonished, but I wasn't deeply offended by it. I was like, it's obviously how that man feels. And this was the point, I think it was Paul Mooney who said, when they asked him, what do you think about it? He said, well, I didn't like it because it wasn't funny. He said, if he had made it funny, you know, I would have appreciated it.
Right.
Is it, but the point that both Patrice O'Neill and Dave Chappelle were making about racial comments, he said, if that's what you really feel, say it.
Right.
Stop this political correctness BS of hiding how you really feel just so that we can all pretend like we like each other.
Right.
Say how you really feel.
Right.
And then I have to have the strength of my own character and my own convictions to hear what you really feel and be able to control my own passions and understand where you're coming from. And I can choose whether or not to continue to deal with you. But this whole thing of like, he should be silenced, that's what that person feels. And if anything, as Dave Chappelle put it perfectly, he said, we can only begin that dialogue about how we really feel about each other and where all this stuff comes from, if we're being honest, right, and we just say what we feel. And it's like, well, that's what that person feels. I mean, it's been said now, and now you know.
Right.
Before, would you were comfortable with being ignorant? Just rather not know.
Of course. But of course it's that way with the majority of people, because they live in their own fears of their own selves. You know, my thing is this, man. I'm not afraid to say what's on my mind and speak whatever truth and peace that I have to speak, because I fear nobody. You know what I mean? And that's the biggest problem. These people are in fear. Mm-hmm. They go to bed in fear. They wake up in fear. They go to work in fear. They go to work. I walk the earth fearless.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have nothing to be afraid of. My father always told me, you know, when I was coming in, I grew up during the civil rights movement. My dad said, look, be a man all the way. You know, you have to, for the sake of yourself and for the sake of what comes out of your seed, what comes from you, which is your seed in the future life mm-hmm. for you. And I made the statement. My statement was, with all the stuff that's going on, the pedophiling and the little homosexual things that be happening with the Catholic churches and all these and outside of the Catholic churches, anybody that put their hands on my children
mm-hmm.
will have to deal with me.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a fact. Now, I don't bite my tongue, and I mean it, and I'll go to the penitentiary the rest of my life when it comes to mine. What's mine is mine, mm-hmm. and I don't let anybody disrespect that, and no one will touch me.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know what I mean? This is the and unfortunately we live in this kind of corrupt society. It's an interesting life that we're in now, and everybody's coming out of the closets and from behind the doors at one time. Like, I don't have a problem with what they do if they stay inside with the and be respectful. You know what I mean? People don't need to see that stuff. It's the same when I see dudes walking down the street with their pants bagging, you know, and their underwear all out, the crack of their butt showing. Nobody want to see that filth, man. You know what I mean? And the women that go for it, it drives me. I'm like, you really, that's what you like? I know what kind of head you got. I know what mind you have.
Grandmaster, I heard you say, no one can touch you. But I think on this one here, I'm putting pause on you on this one.
I got one. I was set up for you. I got one for you.
All right, we're going to take this one out to the break. Right. Play a little music. I'm putting pause on you on this one, right? You feeling this?
No, nah. I got you, though.
Okay. Tell them what we're doing here, man.
You are listening to Jerry Bell's R&B Soul Classics, and you're being educated at the same time. Here on LATalkLive.com, we are open, and we have open conversations and sessions about many different things. We do not bite our tongues and stutter here. Come and see us, visit us, call in, speak what you want to speak on your mind, or either request a song, 323-247-7443. We'll see you after the station identification.
If one's not good enough, I'll bring you two. I'll change the skies from old to blue. Love was made just for two.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Starla Quarles, and I'm inviting you to join us every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. for a new show right here on LA Talk Live, The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. Join us as we discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. So don't forget to tune in to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People, every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. right here on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Jennifer Tapiero from StarCam. You guys might know me from the red carpet, catching up with all the stars, but guess what? We're bringing the red carpet to the radio right out here on LA Talk Live. I'm going live Thursday nights at 6 p.m. We got hot topics, celebrities, and much more. We were featured on Chloe Lamar on E!, Howard Stern, T.I.'s Family Hustle. You know how we do. So check it out on Thursday nights, 6 p.m. All things Hollywood, everything celebrity. StarCam Radio?
StarCam Radio.
StarCam Radio!
Oh yeah, follow us on Twitter, at StarCam Radio.
Hey everybody, it's your man Sabir Bey, back on your airwaves, inviting you to join us every Tuesday, 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, on the Sabir Bey Show, discussing history, law, and hip-hop. Every Tuesday, 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, the Sabir Bey Show, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You also can catch us on iTunes Radio and R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch us and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
I'm sick of you.
Yeah, baby.
This is the sounds of the mighty, mighty OJs.
OJs.
Yes, indeedy.
Wow.
That's what y'all hearing. 992 arguments. And that song was written by my partners, my brothers who are no longer with us, but they were my partners and my writing partners, McFadden and Whitehead.
Yes, indeedy.
So don't think that they just did Ain't No Stopping Us Now and didn't have anything else. They did a lot of hits on the Philly International label. The biggest hits that they did for, actually for the OJs, to give the OJs their real major start out was For the Love of Money and Backstabbers.
Mm.
You know? So, yeah, and then he produced a lot of other things, man. They did the Destiny album on the Jacksons, you know, Heartbreak Hotel and Can You Feel It and all that stuff with Gam and Huff. And they did Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, Bad Luck. You know, got a lot of, I mean, just tons of hits that they came out with. Also, in that stable was Bunny Siegler, who wrote Who Am I on a lot of the OJ stuff, which was the back of the... the back of
don't
the,
get nervous, Grandmaster. This is merely some background music. Since you had to take it to the ground with the fight, with 992 arguments.
Yes, indeed.
Lord have mercy.
So he's gonna come back with Shiva Horn. from the intro of it, when I hear the wind blowing, I already know. Remember, I was in the studio when these things were being recorded, so my ears are good. You know what I'm saying?
You pulled out a great classic though, brother.
Oh yeah.
I just did the best that I could do. I am not worthy, but I shall try.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen.
What a song, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
The OJs.
Yeah.
Now, from 992 Arguments, which to me is a classic R&B hit, and the musicology of that song, you know, if you listen to the instruments, we're not talking about computer-generated instruments. We're talking about cats really in the studio. Am I right?
That's right. Playing every instrument that there is, from violins. There was no keyboard. There was no computers at that time. So, you know, everybody played and wrote. You had to write musical notes, and everyone read. And for those who didn't read, they can hear. Their keen sense of hearing was so dynamic and unique that all you had to do was tell them what to play, and they'd play it, or hum it to them, and they would play it, you know. The sounds that you're hearing are the sounds of the OJs in the background, Ship Ahoy, Gamblin' Huff, McFadden and Whitehead, Bunny Siegler, T. Life. And on these, the musicians on this was MFSB Orchestra.
So those percussions, yes, those indeed. Orchestral drums.
Yeah.
Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah.
Word?
Yeah, man. Beautiful, beautiful. Let's let them hear a little bit, you know.
Your eyes can see, men, women, and baby slaves coming to the land of liberty, where life's design is already made. So young and so strong, they're just waiting to be saved. Oh, I'm so tired. Ship ahoy, ship ahoy, ship ahoy, ship ahoy, ship ahoy. fish in the sea.
Oh yeah, baby.
And that's exactly why I can never challenge the grandmaster in music, because I can't sing. I can't hit the minor notes, but I'll sure try.
So you hit me with something.
The mighty, mighty OJs.
Yes, man. Indeedy.
Why
yes,
you got to put the mighty, mighty in front of them?
Because they are mighty in voice and sound.
Voice
Eddie
and
LaVert.
Sound.
Oh, man. You know what I mean? The voice of Eddie, man, was just immaculate, you know.
Now, this is one of those first releases, at least by my reflection. Mm-hmm. And again, I'm not a musician. I don't pretend to be. But I do love music, so I will consider myself a musicologist.
Mm-hmm.
One of those great, great songs from this era in the early 70s, when you started to see one song become the EP, extended play.
Mm-hmm. Right.
This song is 7 minutes. No, check that. 9 minutes and 40 seconds long.
Right.
So you could be grooving to this. And I'm going to tell you how I did it. In the Blue Light basement.
Yeah.
With some good old dirt weed rolled up in a zigzag. With the homies sitting around throwing back some Thunderbird and Bally High. With some girls from the neighborhood just sitting back. And there wasn't all of this sexual overtone of those moments.
Right.
Mm. We'd be some cool young cats sitting back in the basement of our mom and them house.
Mm.
And the girls would be there with us, man. And we would just be there grooving.
But you know, the thing I think you all were doing too is that you were contemplating over life itself. Because
yeah,
that's what the music that we were doing predicted the things that were happening on the planet. And especially in the United States at the time. You know, the Vietnam era. A lot of the stuff that was going on with the police, you know, during the civil rights movement. So our writing and productions were based upon, you know, very powerful ethics.
But that's just black folks. Black folks, we have always in this country been asking the question, what is this? Why is this? Why am I here?
Why
Who
me?
Am I? What's going on?
I didn't know.
Who
Why
is that
me?
Dude? Why do they act the way they act? It's just the nature of our, and I don't care what subgroup you deal with. Every group of black folks, every group of Africans in this country, in this continent, is always asking the question, always sitting bound. We're very reflective people, and we're always reflecting on what's the situation, what's going on. Even now, in this day and time, when everyone in the country is running, escaping, trying to run away from themselves, trying to run away from their problems. This is the time when you would think that black folks, as much as we've been through, would start escaping ourselves. Some of us do, but for the most part, the question is still being asked. What's going on? Why is this the way it is? And that is the great lesson we have to teach to humanity, is that that's the state of being most people should be in most of the time. You should be reflecting on, you know, what do I do with today? What am I doing with tomorrow? Am I going to be here tomorrow? And that's a person who's dealing with truth, who's dealing with reality.
And living in the moment.
But not only that, every man and woman has to ask them, has to remind themselves when you look in the mirror, I have a responsibility on this planet. You ain't just here just to ride the wave and, you know, call it quits and go party and drink and get high, just like a lot of people have been doing with their lives. And then they look up and 10 years from now, you know, they old, and the drugs and the alcohol that made them older than what they really should be. And their life is about over. You know, you have a responsibility, even if you don't have children, you have a responsibility to the planet. You have a responsibility to the person next to you. You have a responsibility to the animals, to the air, to the
You have
elements.
A responsibility, in fact, if I may add, Grandmaster, to the purpose that birthed you.
That's right.
You have a responsibility to the purpose that birthed you.
That's correct.
Find that purpose.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yep. And you owe it to your ancestors,
You owe it to them. You owe it to the lyrics of this song that you're hearing, of the things that took place upon this earth, which most of our people try to run from. They want to hide and don't want to think, well, that happened to me. I wasn't there. I don't know. You know, you have a responsibility. And when you go to the grave, you will definitely have to pay for everything that you've done. You got to pay it back. Mm. The earth will call you back and you have to pay it back. You know, I got one for you, brother.
Okay, Grandmaster.
Are you ready for me?
I am in full learning mode. My hands, my arms, my mind.
Here we go.
Spirit.
It's on.
Let's give it a listen.
Yes.
I see the world at peace. It brings joy to my heart. Joy to my heart. And in my imagination, I see my children run free. It brings joy to my heart. Joy to my heart. There was a time when I knew you looked down for me. But baby, now you send me for to be free. Girl, you broke my heart, but I took it like a man. But now it's time for this old man to take a stand. You know that in my desperation, they are my inspiration. They bring joy to my heart. Joy to my heart. This morning I got a summons to appear. The judge told me I had to pay my money here. He told them I never did a damn thing. How could you lie and bring my life so much shame? You know that in my imagination, somebody tell me, what do we force and fight? Somebody tell me, every day and every night.
Yes. So the sounds you are hearing in the background, the song is called Child's Imagination, and that is none other than myself, Jerry Bell, that you're listening to.
I knew that's what it
so
was.
So I see the Grandmaster is not above throwing sand into the eye during battle.
You know, wow. So let me give you a little history on this song. I was going through a custody battle with my twins, and unfortunately with their mom, and we were going back and forth to court, and so I didn't have a lawyer to represent me, and so she had this female lawyer who was totally against men, and she was hitting me with these blows, you know, and I'm like,
I can't lose my sons because I love my boys, right? So I said, I went to the studio and I sat down and wrote this song. And I came back and I asked the bailiff to give it to the judge to listen to. And the judge asked the question, what do you want? And I said, I don't think either one of us should have total custody to themselves. So I asked for joint custody and that's what we got.
Now, I'm going to assume that's not Gerald Albright.
No, that's actually David Sanborn.
Oh, man. Wow. One of my favorites.
Yeah, that's my man, David.
One of my favorites.
Listen to the end of this.
I got to give it to him that one now. Brahima has proffered a request, but before he does, I wanted to take a moment out to talk about that particular song, man. David Sanborn on the saxophone. Now, in the background is my retort. A little Terry Collier, What Color Is Love? Because it's so apropos to the song you just posed. Speaking about the crucible of the moment that carved that song out of your incredible talent. Let's go back to that a little bit.
Yeah. I was just so distorted and heartbroken because I've never been able to understand how two people can lay in the bed with one another and bring about such beauty, and then in one breath you love one another and then in the next breath I hate you, and because I don't do what you want, or I can't control you, or you don't love me like I wanted to be loved, you know. And I think it's a lot has to do with the lack of the love that they got from their parents, you know, whether it be male or female, you know. And when you have this anger and this thing going on between you, the only thing it does is it destroys the children. It nothing happens to you, but the greater destruction comes to the children. And it was hard heartening. I could have taken a step if I wanted to, because of knowledge that I have. I could have actually taken them completely from her, but I chose, which she was being told to do that with me, but which I chose to say no. I'm not going to pull that coin out of my hat. I think we both should share in the fact of, you know,
the joy
of their lives, and that we both have much to offer to them. I know I have a great deal as a father, but you know, moms can offer as much as they can offer. You know, dad has to come in, and then it has to be on another level, you know. And in this world out here, I'm telling you, man, if my parents would have known and told me what it was going to be like, or what I had to deal with, what I was going to run into in this is a cold world, man.
It couldn't have made you no tougher, though, Grandmaster. Yeah. They couldn't have prepared you better.
Yeah.
And they couldn't have made you no tougher against the storm.
Yeah. Yeah.
What color is love? Would you give it a color?
Love is transparent.
When it's over, does it show? Does it leave an afterglow? And I really want to know.
That's a
I
great
love the
statement.
Lyrics, man.
Love would be transparent. Yeah. Because at the end of the day, love is truth. You know, when you put all your beautiful, funky truth out there, and that person still looks at you and says, I want all of that.
I'll take it.
Yeah.
Right. That's love.
Yeah.
Word.
You know what I mean? There is no color to love. You know what I mean? It's very transparent. You can see through it, and through its through the person that it's coming from.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, whether that, and you know whether a person loves you or not.
Mm.
You know what I mean? The problem is with most people, especially here. I've lived abroad, man, in other countries, and one thing that I've learned was
to let go. You know what I mean? You can't hold anything. You can't make somebody love you. You can't make something be what it is not. You can only let it be what it was meant to be. And you appreciate it for that time period in your life. And you move on.
And is it not true that we don't own anything in life? We just get to enjoy it.
Hey, man, we came here naked. We will leave the same way, even with the clothes that they may put on you when they put you in a coffin. You know what I mean?
Ashes to ashes.
And mm-hmm. dust to dust.
Ants to ants.
And worms to worms, brother.
Worms to worms.
So I see that you're going to hit me with some Stevie Wonder.
Well, this was a request, Grandmaster. I'm tagging out.
Okay. So he's going to help you battle against me, huh?
I tapped out, Grandmaster. Okay. I tapped out.
So my right goal.
That's a heavy Stevie Wonder. It's one of my favorites.
Yeah, I love this song.
Can I finish on a little story?
Please.
My father... I still have the stereo system my father had when he was a kid. Kenwood, see. Old school American construction.
Old fashioned Kenwood. I love those.
I still have that. I just had the transistors changed on it. It still works beautifully. But he also had, and I'm trying to get that from him, trying to get him to unass that last piece. But it's this record player.
Ooh.
And it's an old wooden, old school record player. And on the front, my father's name is Ken. He had a sticker. And it had two little hands on it, and it said "Hands off, Ken." And I remember
girls like that.
I remember
when he brought them back to the crib. Oh, let me turn on my Kenwood.
I remember sneaking as a kid, playing this album, and looking up at that sticker and said "Hands off, Ken." And I was like, I would be pristine with those albums, so they wouldn't know that I was playing that record. Oh yeah.
And this was the one.
This was one of the yeah.
Wow. How old were you then?
I must have been 7.
Listen to the warmth of this music, man.
The force of evil plan to make you its possession.
Force of evil plan to make you its possession.
If we let it destroy everybody.
We have a live duet. Keep going.
Precautionary measures. If love and peace you treasure, then you'll hear me when I say, oh, Lord, that love in me. Today, don't delay, get yours in right away. Hey, go around breaking any hearts. Stop, baby, please, before it goes too far.
All right. This ain't the studio. At least not the recording studio.
I love it.
But the live studios of LA Talk Live, indeed. A request by my brother, Brahima Salam. An excellent one at that. We have run out of time.
So
we do have time. Of course, Grandmaster.
As we go?
I'm not going to do you like that.
Oh, thank you. All right. I'm going to hit you with
ride this out a little bit. Let's tell them what they got to look forward to next week on your show.
Next week on my show, wow, man, we have a very powerful musical show. We have the great Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Got to put some Mighty Mighty on that, too.
Yes, sir, the Mighty Earth,
Mighty
Wind,
Mighty.
And Fire. Got my main man, Ralph Johnson, and also Verdeen, the white man, here. And... And we also have Tosh that's coming in. She's going to do some spoken word.
Tosh from Sabir Bay
Show. Sabir Bay Show,
co-host
yeah.
of the Sabir Bay Show.
Yes, indeedy. Every Tuesday.
3 p.m. Pacific time.
That's right.
You're on the Talk Live broadcast number.
That's right.
Word.
Yeah, man.
All right, so that's going to be a great show.
Yeah, man.
We'll have Brahima Salam back.
Yes, indeedy.
Inshallah, I'll be here with you.
Oh, yeah, brother. We're yes, going to have some more fun, too. We're going to battle some Earth, Wind, and Fire, too.
You like it, <isn't> it? You see, I went deep on my Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Yeah.
My EWF goes deep. I'll take you back to the first album.
Okay.
All right. Word.
I'm going to come with something on you, you know.
All right. Well, you, yeah. Okay.
But I got something for you right now, though.
Okay. All right. So, I want to thank all of the great people who have been on your show thus far.
Yes,
indeed. I want to encourage all of those folks to stay tuned, spread the word about this great show, bringing back the great sounds of soul and R&B.
Yeah.
All right, so that means that you cannot walk up to the great Jerry Bell or Rahima Salaam on the street complaining about the fact that they don't play good R&B and soul anymore. You can't say that to them no more. All you got to do is tune into them every Wednesday, 2 to 4 Pacific Standard Time, and get what you want. Send your request, all that good stuff.
That's right. And you know, no disrespect to anybody. You know, we're here to educate you on every level. You know what I mean? And we're here to have discussions. We talk freely about everything because we're not limited here.
That's
we
right.
are free,
we
as a matter of fact,
want.
Thanks to the proprietor,
oh, well.
Mr. Rich, my man.
God is greatest.
Nice. Yes, sir.
No, you know,
he allows me to say what I want to say and what I feel, and that's what I mean. And so I have the opportunity to speak freely about topics and various things. And for those who can't handle it, I don't know what to tell you, baby. You know,
we'll send your responses in.
Yeah.
All in and argue.
Yeah, that's right. I get some earplugs.
Step to the grandmaster if you like.
That's what we need in this country. We need more discussion. And
well, you know,
people throwing mud across the.
Sure.
Get in there. Roll your sleeves up. Say what you really feel.
Yeah. Come on with it. I know how to fight.
He's a grandmaster with his foot all in your face.
Yes, indeed.
All right, so thank you, Grandmaster.
Thank you, brother.
Once again,
and,
for allowing me.
You are listening to the sounds of Mr. Stevie Wonder in the background. And you're on the LATalkLive.com, Jerry Bell's R&B Soul Classics.
So we're I know you're anxious you. To throw that last kick, so
yeah.
I'm going to go ahead and fade this song out for you.
You ready to get kicked in the head?
You've been anxious to throw that last kick.
Fingers been on the button the whole time.
I saw it on the floor. I'm like, that kick's coming. I'm probably not going to be able to block it because it's going to come so fast. Going to give it to us. Oh. Man down.
I had to hurt
you. Okay, you heard me.
We'll see you guys soon on LATalkLive.com every Wednesday from 2 to 4. Jerry Bell's R&B Soul Classics. Peace and love.
Peace.
About you, girl. Chills run up and down my spine. And if my wish would come true, girl, I'd be with you all the time.
Tuning in to LA Talk Live, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.